crew here, Jimmy Toscano, Bobby Manning, all right, let's see what happens. We know, so just to catch people up, we already jumped on the stream, Bobby and I, at around 12, just shortly after 12 o'clock, and at that point, the Celtics had made a move, a single move, and one that was expected to be maybe the first domino to fall, which would have been Evan Fournier coming to the Celtics. It is now 2 o'clock. There's an hour till the NBA trade deadline. The Celtics are – everything is as quiet as it can possibly be. I haven't heard the Celtics mentioned in anything in a long time. Last reports we got were that maybe they could be looking to trade big because some teams were interested. You're hearing nothing on names like Lonzo, nothing on names like John Collins at all. No buzz at all.
Nada.
And so right now it is really trending towards the Celtics. It looks like the Celtics might be done. And if that's the case, we'll have to judge this move on its own merit as the only thing that they're going to do this year, which I know is not going to thrill a lot of fans. I think all three of us actually don't think it's a bad move, and we do think it makes them better now. So, Bobby, you were the most vocal when we were talking about it earlier. Just break down what the Celtics are getting in Fournier.
Well, you're getting a couple of different things. You're getting a shooter first and foremost. He's a rock solid shooter. Some nights great. Can get to the basket a little bit. Might be able to generate a few more free throws for you, and can be a secondary ball handler off of Jason Tatum, off of Jaylen Brown. This is a guy that has generated 5 free throws a game with Orlando this year on the ball. And he's going to be shooting wide open shots. I mean, he's been a guy that has been keyed in all year with the Magic as one of their top options. And he's still shooting 39%. Defense, there's ups and downs with him. I know Goodman tweeted out that he had a source rate him as a good defender. I think that's fair. And I think what's important to consider, too, is the Magic are one of the worst teams in the league this year. But when Fournier is on the court, they're a net even, which would indicate that they're getting by on both ends of the floor with him better than they have been, you know, with any other options out there this year. He's a really good fit in this offense. He can work on the ball, off the ball. He's 28. And as I said earlier, I think there's some real sense that the Celtics can either move him during the offseason effectively or keep him here long term, which I think both would be good options ultimately. And he's 6'7", which I don't think a lot of people realize too. There's real size here.
And Jimmy, I want your take. I just want to add something to Bobby. 6'7", I don't know if he starts right out of the gate because they have no time to practice and chemistry is going to be an issue. But this is a natural fit in the starting lineup with the two Jays, Kemba Walker and a big, depending on who's left on the roster when this is all said and done, but presumably Tice if he doesn't get moved. And that's a much better lineup than what they're doing. And at this point, it looks like Marcus Smart is staying at least through this season. So now you have him in your second unit. Along with who the hell knows what else is really going to go there, obviously, at this point. But Fournier obviously adds that depth. He's also very good on handoffs and pick and roll. So there are different things that he can do. He can score on all three levels. I think that's important for this team. 19 points a game in Orlando. For this team, he's really more of a fourth option. So I think this is a guy you can count on for 13, 14 points a night, which, again, we're talking about, and we talked about it, Jimmy. This is this guy versus – in terms of this season improvements, it's Fournier minutes versus Semi Ojeleye minutes. And it's not really, really close at all in terms of offensive production. So just, Jimmy, your thoughts on Fournier.
Yeah, so you can look at it in a few different ways, right? So in a vacuum, this is a great trade. I mean, you gave up 2 second-round picks, essentially nothing in terms of, you know, assets. And you brought in a player who is a starter, is averaging, you know, around 20 points a game, whether or not he averages that in Boston. He's a proven scorer, a proven veteran, by all accounts, a good personality. I don't want to say he's a locker room guy because I don't know that, but I'm assuming that he is based on what I've read and what I've seen other people say about him. I think he's underrated. Obviously, playing in Orlando, he hasn't gotten a ton of publicity. I haven't even gotten to do my YouTube highlight reel yet. So
I was going to ask, did you get the all positive tape yet?
I didn't get the all positives yet. I'm working on it. There's less out there than there was for Aaron Gordon. Obviously, you don't have some of those highlight reel dunks, but you're getting a player that Bobby mentioned. I mean, he can score. He's a shooter. He's going to fit in. John mentioned this. He's going to fit in very nicely in this starting lineup as that as that, you know, wing swing type player. So they're going to be able to do more of a traditional lineup there. I think also, and I just retweeted Brian Robb. Listen, they made this trade. First of all, it does make them better, right? That's obvious because he's not a Semi and he's not a Javonte Green and all those guys that they've been signing. He makes them better this year. Where it gets hairy now is, okay, Danny H has gone on the radio and said, we're not going to trade for a player that's in the last year of his deal and that who can cash in the offseason, and we're not going to go over the cap. Well, what do you do with this move? Exactly both of those things. So I'm very interested to see how it plays out from here. I think they do want to re-sign him. I think that's probably the whole point of this, because while it does make them better, it doesn't make them the Nets. It doesn't make them the Bucks. It doesn't make them, you know, these top-tier teams. It does make them better. It does make them a tough out, for sure. But I think that they're looking further than this year with that deal. Now,
or you sign and trade him and create a what?
Exactly. That's what I retweeted. Just what I retweeted from Brian Robb. They can trade him for another drum roll TPE. Yes, they can do that. So is it kind of like kicking the can down the curb a little bit? Maybe. It's not going to be the same number of TPE, so it's a smaller TPE and therefore less valuable.
Plus your $11 million
You still can't combine them, though. You can't
combine
them. That's the tricky thing. You got like five, you got four, you can't combine any of them.
You do get one, and you don't just lose it. I know Bobby's been screaming into the camera for the last few months, if they don't use it, they're just going to lose it. So now, theoretically, they could
– You got another year. Yeah.
Open up a new one, yes. Now, I know that's not what Celtics fans typically, you know, theoretically want, and I don't think it's what we want. And when you're talking about the TBE, I think a lot of fans thought – and we tried to tell them. We did try to tell them, but I think a lot of fans thought that they could get back this – $28 million level player with the TPE. Well, it's not the case. You're going to get somebody's, we use the word junk. I'm not going to say Fournier is junk, but he's a player they didn't want.
An expiring deal.
And you
It's almost like we knew what we were talking about, Jimmy.
Right. The only thing we said was that you're going to have to give something with the TPE. They really didn't have to in this case, which is a positive.
It was either or, Jimmy. Something for a player like Gordon, which we haven't fully gotten into, but you know, if you don't know the news yet, I'm going to break something to you in a minute.
you would need to give something real
for Gordon, or for a player of his caliber, which would have been, you thought, I mean, I guess there was talk there. If you see that what the deal was, yes, Denver gave up real things for him. So absolutely, you had to give up something real. Nothing in the TPE for something a team just wanted to get off its books, which they did, and they're fine.
And
this is the best player they could have gotten under those circumstances, I think. Best player available for 2 second round picks and virtually nothing but a piece of paper.
Right. So it doesn't really necessarily hurt them by making the deal, unless you ended up with a situation where this megastar was available and, you know, the TPE that they had before they used it on Fournier would have been, you know, the perfect fit for it. Now that's a rare circumstance that, you know, might not happen. And that was the risk of holding on to it and doing nothing. So I think people like Bobby are very happy today because he said it would have been, you know, absolutely unacceptable if they didn't do anything today. They did. And based on what we know on the hard cap and the luxury tax and the roster spots, it sounds like, and Bobby, I'm sure you could talk about this in depth. It sounds like they can't be done, right? They've got to do something to avoid the tax.
Well, they're $2 million from the hard cap right now, so there's not much else they can do. They can move something out and still get a player like
things out, right?
So that's the question.
You could theoretically
right now
still trade for John Collins, who's only a $3 million salary currently, right now. But you still have to move something out, and you got to create roster space because they're already over 15. So something's going to happen. I do want to add to Jimmy's thing, though, as we say, doing it with nothing, and then Bobby jump in here on all of the cap stuff. This is still, you know, like we said, when Hayward left, the deal became, and it just keeps growing. It was, well, Hayward is really Tristan Thompson and the TPE. So now Hayward has become Tristan Thompson and Evan Fournier.
In 4 seconds.
And you gave up 4 seconds as well. So Fournier could in turn become something else down the road. So you're going to keep kicking this can down the road. You don't really know at the end of the day. And you're always going to compare that versus Miles Turner and Dougie McDermott because you think you could have gotten them theoretically.